cost of ownership to the customer and still deliver value. So all of these are things that generally get asked around when your product is going through a rough patch. So what happens is most of us can relate our stories in companies or across products from the trunk of a tree. There were, let us say, 5 to 10 developers at release 1. At release 2, it became 20 to 40. Release 3, maybe it remained 35, 40. At release 4 is like multiple geographically distributed teams managing the whole release and product across different countries and time zones. And obviously, the release 1, the technology stack was quite primitive. 2, it has again changed hands, it became complex. 3, it became even more complex. And 4 is quite large. So unless you have a portfolio management of systems, there are instances when people go dig deep into the code, and finally the code is the final version of truth, and that is what you end up doing. So unless your fair product management strategy is in place, everybody ends up working a lot, and still you don't end up with a great product story. But it looks like all the way you're working very hard, people are staying overnight, and still you're not able to get around, get a fair amount of your market share. So all of this can actually be overcome if you do proper portfolio management. And how do you create your artifacts, resources? How do you employ people by creating a reference architecture and make sure people understand your story that you're trying to tell them? So if you see these days, any product or solution is simply moved itself away from technology, and it's become more of a business problem being solved using technology. And at the core of everything, you actually have a vision. Say I want to sell a social app connecting people. So let us say that is a vision. Then how do you enable it? In what tablets or mobiles or the web portals is that making it available through? And obviously there is a business flow around it which composes your business architecture. How are users going to interact with your social app? How are they going to connect to the system? How are they going to transact? And what is the ultimate value add in terms of their life experience by using your application? And next comes your information architecture, which is nothing but your application and data architecture. Application, what kind of applications will I use to solve this business problem, and what will be my data set for solving my problem? And then I leverage all of this using a technology stack, which can be either .NET or Java or Ruby on Rails or Scala or whatever is the latest on the product line. So at the end of it, this is how most of your industry standard frameworks look like. If you apply Zachman or TOGAF or Philips 4+1 view, the ultimate aim is you end up with a reference architecture which ensures that you manage your product or solution well, and the output is a reference architecture for people to see and use. And so that everybody, it's like a guiding star in your company, wherein you understand what is required from the architecture, and everybody knows what pieces belong to them and what is really required from their teams for making sure the other pieces talk to each other. So previously the scenario was in the waterfall model, you create an architecture, then a product, and so on. But these days you have a product and you don't have too much time for architecture, so you build an architecture around it. When things stabilize, you fail, make mistakes, and learn from your iterations. So in either case, you need an architecture around your product or a solution. So there are no two ways about it, you still need an architecture, whether you belong to the old way of doing things or you're using agile practices, you still need an architecture for people to actually get value and increase employee productivity in your company. So what does it actually cure? It helps you to see the myopic vision thing, because what happens is when your lines of code is well under a couple of hundreds or thousands or 100,000 lines of code, it's still manageable. But when it simply gets beyond that, you end up with actually a blurred vision, which is, you know, I can't see what my roadmap head looks like. Let us say your product head or your company, your top management says, okay, I want this, I want to move my application to the cloud. Can you tell me how many man days are you going to take? So you don't have an answer for it unless you made sure that all the nuts and bolts of the system is known to everybody, at least the people who matter in the teams. By using AFN's architecture, you'll not have the quickest answers to these simple questions, or you will not be able to service their demands in a fast and quick way. So what is that, what are the problems that actually hinder this? Basically, you don't know what all the pieces that make up your overall landscape of things. How do two of my components talk to each other? What is the interoperability concerns here? What kind of protocols they talk to each other, and so on? Then, of course, everything started very simple. They ended up becoming monolithic and complex. What is usually referred to as a big ball of mud. So everything sticks to each other. Let us say you want to the customer of your product. He wants, let us say, only the if you have a couple of modules, he wants a module by name credit card rating as a separate entity, and he says, okay, I'm going to pay you for I want four modules of your entire puzzle, and I'm going to pay you for that. So you're not able to break up your puzzles, your architecture into smaller concerns and then separate it out to the people who want it that way, because they don't want to end up paying for your monolithic architecture. Instead, they want only a part of your thing, and you're not ready. So this happens if you don't actually separate your concerns over a period of time, because unless this thought process is there in the company and you have a set of people actually who think on these lines, it can't be end of day requirement. So you need people thinking along these lines right from day one. Otherwise, you'll not be able to remove the knots and give them what they want. So again, you need to classify your architecture artifacts systematically so that there is a proper method in what is being done, so that people write the UI code at the UI layer, the business logic in the business layer, the data layer in the data layer, and the application code, the glue code, the platform code which binds all of this should be put inside the platform layer, and there should not be any business logic at that level. So what kind of components go into what sections, and how do you string an architecture around it? If people have worked with extensions, they know what this means. So again, the same thing, that you want to remove few plugins from your overall product and then sell them to your end customer, you will need to know how to do this efficiently without losing the cohesiveness of the entire architecture. So yeah, how do you make sense that various architectures, at times you end up buying companies, there are companies which are part of mergers and acquisitions. So each of the products which is serving different purposes, so how do you actually bring it all together? How do you unify them using a uniform standard? So what kind of connectors, what kind of adapters do you write here, and how do you actually stitch the pieces together? So finally, all of this, these are all the pain points which are there if you don't have a reference architecture. So how do you solve all of this is using this concept called separation of concerns. So there's this famous Phillips 4 plus 1 view of segregating your concerns. So what he says is any product solution can be broken up into four different components, which is the logical view, the component view, deployment view, the process view. And there is a cloud-like thing, which is basically a business scenario use cases, which sits on top of all of this. So at the end of doing all of this, what is that I am actually delivering as a business value to my end customer? So any framework, if you were to look at in today's modern world, all of them you can pretty much relate it to this 4 plus 1 view, which says that I've got my the entire product or solution compartmentalized into these views, and all of these actually serve a broader agenda of serving a business case, which is basically a business scenario use case which sits on top of these four views. So if you look at it, you will pretty much have all your UML diagrams compartmentalized into these figures. One is the logical view, the component view, then the deployment view, and the process view. So many times when you're doing a load test or you're doing a concurrency test, you need to know what is my concurrency view of my architecture. Where in my architecture, across what value objects or across what particular shared data that I can expect lock condition or a deadlock. So unless you actually created, done your due diligence in understanding your system and know where I can expect thread locks, deadlocks, and unless you've done it, it's not easy to find it out at that moment. So you have to end up doing a firefighting exercise, which is actually painful, and most often it gets done if you don't plan this when things are not very busy in the companies. So let us look at how all of these frameworks actually approach these concerns. So at everything starts from a conceptual view, then it boils down to the logical view, then it comes to the physical or technical view. So at the apex of the pyramid you have the conceptual view, and from the conceptual view you come to the logical view, and then you come to your physical or technical view, which is nothing but how you go ahead and implement what is discussed at a conceptual view. So what are some examples of this thought process? Let us say